Hello, and I am very pleased to be here, although I have to say I did have a little bit of anxiety preparing for this talk, for this audience of people and representatives of companies that are doing a lot to show their commitment to sustainability, you know, especially as we're a company who, you know, every night when I turn on the, not me physically, but we turn on the printing presses, I can hear the screams of dead trees. And secondly, when people talk about sustainability, you know, it is usually in the context of the environment, but when they talk to us about sustainability, it's like, how long do you think you've got? So anyway, so I thought, what could I talk to you about today that might be of use to you from the perspective of a media company? And I think, you know, really what I want to talk about is why a sustainable local news media is essential if any of us are going to achieve the aims that we have for our wider society. Globally, the business models that have traditionally funded your news have been completely disrupted over the last decade. In fact, media is the most disrupted of industries. I find it hard to remember a time when we weren't talking about the disruption of our business. Stuff, for example, is almost 20 years old. So that's how long that digital disruption has been impacting our business. You know, all over the world, news companies are really in a struggle for survival. You're either working hard to create new business models to survive, which is what we're doing, or you're collapsing and going under, and that has happened a lot overseas. So this is a problem for us in the media as, at a personal level, of course, but I really wanted to talk to you about why it's a much bigger problem for everybody else. So the role of journalism really is to hold the powerful to account. That's what we're there to do. It's an essential function, I believe, of a healthy democratic society. And we are there to keep our government and business institutions honest and keep them accountable for their actions for the rest of us. So we should all be profoundly concerned about the sustainability of local journalism, because once that disappears, those checks and balances will also disappear. Already in countries like the USA and the United Kingdom, we have seen the closure of hundreds of local newspapers and local newsrooms, brought on by the shift of readers and advertisers to new technology, new platforms, new technologies. It's the way the world is going. And we can't turn back the tide on that societal and technological shift. We wouldn't seek to. But the situation does really leave unresolved that problem on how to sustain and fund the journalistic institutions that are there to shine that light on the abuse of power and to turn over the stones that powerful would rather we didn't, when the business models that always sustain those over, you know, 160 years in our case, have really rapidly disintegrated. And probably most concerning that is that among the newsrooms finding it hardest to keep an eye on local government are the local newsrooms, the small regional ones in towns and rural areas where you know, they rely on a small group of readers and a small group of advertisers to fund them, but they have a really important role to play in keeping an eye on local authorities and regional and rural industries and the management of natural resources. Their work and their focus really plays a critical role there. And you know, these days I know from our own reporters all around the country that in those areas particularly, a lot of their work is that it's increasingly focused on the management or mismanagement of vital natural resources and investigating issues of sort of abuse of resource consents and things like that. They're really important to the physical community that they're in, but they have a much wider importance to the rest of us. And I can think of countless examples of that very local journalism exposing unethical, illegal, or just shoddy, ill-educated actions by those local institutions who should be safeguarding our precious resources for the future, but have not. And I'm thinking of examples like Charlie Mitchell, our environmental and climate reporter, who's based in Christchurch, who's done a series of really important work on the water issues, water management issues around Christchurch and Canterbury, and the need for more sustainable dairying practices there. Or the one story that always comes to mind for me is about a rural district council, who I shall not name here, who awarded a multi-million dollar wastewater contract to a local cake decorating business that had no experience there. And that was really came to light because a local reporter exposed that and reported on it, and it did end up being overturned and there was an inquiry. Those are the things that are just so important to make sure we are keeping track of. And there is plenty of evidence to show that when local newsrooms go under, local government runs unchecked. So if you've got a hankering to indulge in corrupt practices or misuse public funds or give high-paying jobs to your relatives, local government is a pretty good place to be right now in some countries, especially in the towns without local newsrooms. And we know, and there is plenty of research to show this now, that in the area where the local newsroom is gone, local politicians care less and work less on behalf of their constituents, and actually voters care less too. Engagement in local issues drops off and trust takes another hit. So without that independent and sufficiently resourced local newsroom, the vacuum is filled then by PR, by managed messages and opinion, by fake news. Even some of the local authorities here, you know, it enrages me actually to see a lot of ratepayers' money being spent by local authorities setting up what they call newsrooms in their own organisations, which are to give people the news that they want them to have with the spin that they want them to have. I have no issue with communications teams and that, but I do take an issue with a public agency trying to create a newsroom to manage its own message of the spending of public money while putting up barriers for journalists to access that same information. So the sustainability, we're not quite in the peril of some of these overseas countries yet, but if the wolf is not right at the door, it's certainly marching up the path. And the sustainability of our local news media here will really have a direct correlation on the level of good behaviour or poor behaviour or corruption from our government and industries in future. We're really learning the hard way, I think, as a society, and most notably through Facebook, that not all is what it seems to be in news today. Fake news, and the phrase fake news is everywhere. I actually hate that term fake news because it links it to the news media, which is actually not the proponent or the creator of fake news, despite the loud shouting of the Donald Trumps of the world, who just really seek to distract from their own unethical or illegal behaviour. Fake news is mass-generated, deliberately targeted use of misinformation to infiltrate political systems and to capture public agendas. And it has compromised our democratic foundations around the world and our institutions. Anyone who's been following the Cambridge Analytica scandals over the last couple of months will have seen how the misuse of millions of users of data from millions of profiles, Facebook users, has actually resulted in the US election being stolen. It has resulted in Brexit and all sorts of other things. It is profoundly worrying for us. And what is more worrying is that when elections can be stolen and the balance of power shifted by the spread of false information, that is just a further knife in the back of trust in the institutions that are actually fighting to prevent it. And because of that scarcity of trust, the importance of truth-telling has been elevated. So it's essential for us news media to build and preserve the trust of our readers and to demonstrate that we deserve that and we can earn that through adhering to the highest standards of accuracy, fairness and balance, and to show that we serve the electors, not the elected. So I just want to talk a little bit now about how we are building a sustainable business model. I will talk about it, how we're going to build a sustainable business model. But first, I just want to show you some of the examples of the high quality journalism that we are investing in really heavily as part of our commitment to serve New Zealanders around the issues that really matter. So just here, you can see two groups of people at the top. They're our investigative teams. The one on the side with Paula Penfold in the front is our Stuff Circuit investigative team. They just spent a year researching a story on the New Zealand deployment to Afghanistan and produced a documentary and a whole series of work out of that that looked at the really murky lead up to the deaths of our soldiers in Afghanistan. Alongside that, we've got a picture of our national correspondence team, who was set up to focus on national coverage of issues that are important to New Zealanders now and into the future. And Katie Kenny, one of those reporters, her round is to look at future technologies, future of work, future disruption. It's a really interesting area. Charlie is there to look at the environment and climate change. And they're an amazing group of young reporters, actually, who produce brilliant work. They've done things like the Faces of Innocence, which you see all that collection of children's faces there. We used every journalist in our group in one way or another to do a project that looked into the deaths of every single child at the hands of another person in New Zealand over the last 20 years. So it's about 220 children. And the saddest thing about that is that for most of those children, there was no information. There was no database about them. There was no one who could tell you anything about their lives or what happened to them. And I don't know, hopefully some of you have seen our latest big project on the Treaty of Waitangi and what really happened to Māori as a result of that process, and really how little they gained out of that and how much they were penalised. I don't think I've had a single editorial project that we have produced that have I've received so much positive feedback from people who said it opened their eyes to our own history. So we have 450 journalists, give or take, around New Zealand. All of them are guided by a code of ethics that's very strictly adhered to and are independent. That means that no advertiser, despite the fact that we are, you know, in an environment where we value every single advertiser very much, but no advertiser can have any impact on the editorial coverage, no matter what, you know, story comes out. You know, our editorial team is completely independent. And that journalism costs us tens of millions of dollars every year. We're really proud and privileged to be able to do that. But there is a fundamental problem when you run what's essentially a public good service, but you're not publicly funded, and you've got to find new ways to continue to have that privilege of being able to serve people in that way. In countries, in the US, for example, 90 cents or more in every new advertising dollar is going to Google or Facebook. In some cities and towns, it's actually gone up to nearly 100%. So we have a huge challenge here to try and really rapidly rebuild the business model that allows us to continue to produce that journalism. So what are we doing? Firstly, we too started by revisiting our purpose. And it's interesting to see the similarities that are coming out with Spark, with some of the others who have talked about their purpose here today. Our purpose, we really distill down, is to help Kiwis connect and thrive in their communities. We've done that for 160 years. We just sort of reframed how we talked about it and used that as the kind of centre of everything we decided to do as we really rethought our business model for the future. In this new attention economy, we have one really big unique advantage in the Stuff platform. It is the biggest digital brand in the country, New Zealand digital brand, and only Facebook and Google and YouTube are bigger than us, and even then by not that much. So that gives us a huge advantage and a unique sort of opportunity to try and leverage that in new ways to diversify our revenues and put those monies back into funding the newsroom that brings the audience to that site. We also have trust and goodwill in a lot of communities that's built through those decades of serving communities through our newspapers. So we set about thinking about different ways to leverage that scale and reach. And we invested in various startups who were completely not anything to do with publishing news. All of a sudden we found ourselves with a lot of extra ad space as people moved to other areas. So we thought, why not use that ad space to market our own businesses and to try and grow our own businesses? So we started up we bought a very small fledgling startup called Neighbourly 3 years ago, which had 46,000 members then. And I'll come back to Neighbourly a little bit later, but it's now over 650,000 members, and we've been able to turbocharge that growth and accelerate it through the use of our own marketing and advertising assets. We did the same with a little ISP, an internet service provider, Stuff Fibre, that we have, which is just a fibre-only ISP. Again, we use our own advertising. One thing we found out that was really good is that advertising actually works. So we've started... good tick. And so we've grown that up to a really... it's producing a lot of new and rapidly growing revenues for us that, again, allow us to support the more traditional parts of the business. We also have an energy company, Energy Club NZ, who, along with Stuff, signed up to the Climate Leaders Coalition the other week. And it's the same thing. We use the scale of our audience, the data that we have, the trust that we have, and the advertising inventory to try and grow up these new businesses that then produce new revenues to come back and replace, or starting to replace at least, the lost revenues that have gone as the whole business model for media has fragmented and changed. We've also got a video on demand company, a retail platform, all sorts of things in there. And a few more sort of in the pipeline for future. This come at great internal disruption, actually, I think, which is one of the biggest challenges. And we've had to make some very difficult decisions that have been caused a lot of angst internally, but been unpopular externally as well. And probably the biggest of those was when we closed a third of our newspapers this year. Actually, we tried to sell them firstly, but that proved to not be that easy. And there was a reason why they were at the bottom of our portfolio. So 28 to 30 community newspapers around the country were no longer viable, and they had to go. But as we were going through that platform, that process, we made the very firm and genuine commitment that we must still have local reporters in those regions and use other platforms to try and reach those audiences. And one of the most important new ways for that is Neighbourly. So Neighbourly, I think today I just saw their latest audience stats, 950,000 monthly audience. It's way bigger than the broadcasters and a lot of other sites. So it's an important new platform for us to reach people very locally. For those of you who don't know what Neighbourly is, please go and join it. I hope you would enjoy it. But it's a hyper-local social network where you sign up and then you become part of your local neighbourhood community. You see the names of your neighbours, where they live. It's a very warm sort of and open environment because it's real names, real address, and people behave impeccably on there. And it's really become what we really dreamed it would be, which is a modern and virtual village square, a place to come to share news, to trade things, to pass things on, to just have a conversation about the things that matter to you. But it is also now a new way for us to bring local news to people, to replace the sort of community newspapers that we haven't been able to sustain. It also leaves a much better environmental footprint. So why is it important that a company like ours has a sustainable future, besides all of us having jobs? But we do believe that what we do has a really strong social value, and we project it through our journalism, but also we try to project it through the way we conduct ourselves in our business and in our external activities. And it means definitely that we have to hold ourselves to the same standards as we hold everybody else to through our news coverage. So internally, we're still working on how to improve our own footprint. We can certainly do better, because the inconvenient truth is that we have a really significant detrimental impact on the environment. We print more than 2 million newspapers a week, and we deliver about 30% of them in non-biodegradable plastic bags, so they don't get wet. So the plastic wrap is 100% recyclable, but not biodegradable, and needs to be funnelled through the soft plastics recycling venues, which we really strongly try to support. We also reduce our carbon footprint by 10% year on year, and I thought, that's great. And then I realised it was because people are buying less newspapers. So... We have quite a large events business. We run some of New Zealand's largest and most iconic events, attended by more than 500,000 New Zealanders each year. Foremost of those is the Ports of Auckland Round the Bays race, which is our favourite event, we love it, and Central District's Field Days. And we aim to make those events zero waste. Through things as simple as, you know, when we run our night noodle markets, we removed single-use cups from those events and had an exchange sort of mechanism, and that saved 30,000 cups from going to the landfill. And we're always looking for sort of new ways to kind of reduce that footprint further. I just want to touch a little bit on the references to changing technologies like AI and robotics, because they are very real for us at the moment. In fact, I only discovered we were already using an AI and stuff by accident when I wandered past one of the developers who happened to be talking about it. And, you know, there are a lot of positive things you can achieve through clever use of machine learning algorithms. I think AI is a term that's probably over-inflated in what actually is happening behind the scenes, but for example, we are right now exploring and will be producing some of our stories that are written by machines rather than humans, but they are data-driven results kind of things, like sports results updates or weather updates or those things that are just a collection of numbers and data. But there are plenty of other things we could do, but should we do it? One of the biggest ethical considerations for us as a news organisation is to make sure that we don't inadvertently build in or reinforce prejudices through the way that we construct our algorithms and what they learn from our source material as they go around. And one example is the AI was talking about discovering already working was actually compiling and building photo galleries for us and publishing them into various parts of the site. There was a mild panic when it decided it got overexcited and started to do hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them all the time, but we've pulled it back. But for years, newsrooms have been criticised, and probably rightly so, for falling into stereotypes in their coverage by, for example, using photos that feature more brown faces than white faces when you're covering poverty or crime. And that goes back to a lot of sort of, you know, human biases really, and not being challenging ourselves correctly in the newsrooms. But there is a real danger that allowing a machine access to that sort of material can really build up and reinforce and amplify those kind of biases, which is in all sorts of ways, which we have to learn to avoid. So we're treating that very carefully and warily. And we're very aware that as a news site, we cannot fall into the same sort of traps that Facebook and the social platforms have fallen into by presenting you with news and views that already fit with what you believe and what you know. That's not our job, it's not to reinforce your beliefs. Our job is to present a wider, you know, more balanced picture. Again, with the slides, I should just give up on having slides, actually. So I think we're looking at how we build in that sort of ethics and sustainability roles within our team to debate and decide on the uses of technologies and the way that that delivers to our readers, as well as things that are more physical in terms of our you know, how we use plastic, for example, or our fleet of, you know, hopefully soon to be Toyota electric vehicles. So what else are we doing? I guess, you know, we're trying to do a lot of things internally around diversity and inclusion. I'm really proud, actually, that our workforce is evenly split for men and women. Even an executive team, we are 50-50. But we're not really a true reflection of New Zealand society yet in terms of ethnicity and other measures. So that's one area we're still working very hard in. And we're trying to increase the number of purpose-led policies and benchmarks and reporting structures we have within our organisation. But I think the most obvious way we can make a contribution to sustainability is by rigorous reporting of the issues around it and using that mass platform that we have, that mass reach, to help affect and shine a light on positive change as well as the things that could be going wrong. We pride ourselves on independent and objective journalism. We can be an influencer. We certainly are an influencer. It's a responsibility you have to balance because it's not our job to set a political agenda or to support one. We can be an educator. And we can also be a call to arms where we are needed. We have really recommitted our news organisation very recently to the concept of constructive journalism. And constructive journalism is all about focusing on solutions and what's working and not just on the crises or the problems or the weight of, you know, doom and gloom in the world. And actually there is a lot that is working, and a lot of the businesses that you are here for are behind that. So some of the things that we've done in that area, well, we helped raise $2 million to buy a beach in the Abel Tasman. Once we got wind of that idea, we got them behind and crowdsourced the funds to raise that. One of the things I am just most proud of, because it's had such a physical impact, is our Nelson newsroom became aware that wasps in the area were becoming a huge problem for tourism and killing native birds by, you know, changing the food cycle, and decided to do something about it. So the editor there really researched and found a locally produced bait, and in conjunction with Doc and the local authorities, she crowdfunded for the cost of the bait for the whole region, and then she organised her readers to come in, pick up the bait and a mat with a little highlighted bit out and go and lay it. And as a result of that, they wiped out between 95 to 99% of wasps in that region. That is a massive physical benefit for a community that was led by the newsroom who held to their purpose of helping their community thrive and helped educate and activate the community around a shared social good. And lastly there, you know, I just want to highlight this piece of work from Charlie, who looked at the diminishing glaciers in our country and has done some spectacular reporting around that. So our reporting is probably, you know, it's the way we can help, in a way, offset some of the damage that we are doing through our manufacturing and hold true to our purpose there. So when I look around the room here, you know, I see a lot of companies that are doing a lot of really good things. And the one thing I really want to ask you all is to think about how you can share your stories with us more. And by that, I mean how you can build the kinds of relationships with your local reporters, whether it's a staff company or someone else, and have a very authentic and genuine connection to tell your stories. Newsrooms now are... they're busy, they're worn down, they're frightened sometimes in terms of their own jobs, but they're also buried under an avalanche of press releases. And for anyone who really wants to get your story across, I'd say the most effective way to do that is to front up your people and your leaders and build those direct connections with your local editor, local journalist, because there is a... When I was a reporter, I could walk into the police station, I was the local police reporter, up to the desk, have a look through the incident book, have a chat to the sergeant about what was worth looking at, what was just not. It was a trusted relationship, and I was able to produce some really good work backed up by the fact that I knew the context, you know, the background, the wider context. Nowadays, I don't think a reporter could set foot in a police station, and they certainly couldn't talk to a real live police officer in person. They have to go through all the sort of comms hoops. And I understand why that sort of has grown up, but it has become a real barrier to accurate and genuine reporting. And often, I think it means that the newsrooms are cynical about the press releases that you might send out, but also that means that they're missing some really genuinely good things that are happening. So please do look for ways to work with us. I'm very happy to talk more about that to anybody or to put up any of our editors or journalists who you might want to come to your teams. So I think what we do, you know, I can't think of a job I'd rather be doing or an industry I'd rather be working in. It is such a great privilege to be let into the lives of New Zealanders at the best and worst moments of their lives and to be able to champion the things that matter to them. And it is challenging for our industry, but I'm also really optimistic about the type of future we're building and the type of business models we're building. And I'm also really inspired that the rest of it is in good hands with companies like you. When I look at the list of people signed up to the Sustainable Business Councils, very powerful. So good luck, and if there's ever anything I can do for you to help augment your story or your purpose, please don't hesitate to get in touch.